Hello, my name is Randy Oplinger, and I'm the Coldwater Sportfish Coordinator for the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources. And today I'm going to be presenting to you the division's proposed fishing regulation changes for the upcoming 2023 fishing guidebook. Before I get into the specific regulation changes that the division is proposing, I'd like to take a moment just to talk about how the Division of Wildlife Resources comes up with our fishing regulation recommendations that we provide statewide. And maybe a little bit more broadly, I'll talk about how we manage our fisheries in our state. This process that we follow is really a data-driven process. So if you look at the figure, it's on the slide. We're taking data from three different sources, which are those blue boxes you see across the top. The first one is biological monitoring. So these are traditional gill net surveys or electrofishing surveys. There's some other monitoring work we do as well. We also get data from biological research, which are typically more in-depth studies we perform on our fisheries. We often perform those in collaboration with university partners. But we also take data from constituent surveys. These are very often creel surveys or online opinion surveys that we conduct. And we take that information from those three different sources and we basically review that information and use that information to make decisions about how we manage our fisheries here in the state. This is really a four-step process. The first step is we set objectives for our fisheries. So these objectives are basically what we would like our fisheries to look like. So they could be angler-driven metrics like desired angler catch rates, or these objectives could be more biologically based, like certain growth rates or certain return rates that we would like to see in our nets. We set these objectives either internally or we set them by working with partners or stakeholders, including our constituents or anglers, when we set the objectives for our fisheries. After we have those objectives, we take the data, we collect it, and then we review that data and we use the data to make recommendations about how we manage our fisheries in the state. When we review those recommendations, again, we might review them internally, but we often involve partners and stakeholders, including anglers, in the review of our data. Once we review the data, that leads to us making a decision about how we manage a fishery. So there's really three lines of action we could take once we've made a decision about how we want to move forward with the management of the fishery. The first thing we may do is make no changes in how we manage our fishery. And we do that in situations where the fishery is meeting its objectives and we feel like we don't need to make any changes in how we manage that water. The second thing we may do are make stocking, habitat, or access changes. And the third thing we may do are regulation changes. When we make a regulation change, those are reviewed and approved by the RACs and the Wildlife Board. Now, the one thing I want to point out is the purple arrows that lead back to the top of this diagram. These exist because this process is actually an adaptive process, so we don't do this once. We're continually looking at the data, comparing the results to the objectives and making decisions about whether our current management is working for a fishery or not working for a fishery. So what this means that through time, we often have to make changes in how we manage our fisheries to ensure our fisheries are continuing to meet their objectives. So the process that we followed this year is very similar to what we've traditionally followed. So we developed our regulation change recommendations and we're bringing those in forward in front of the RACs and Wildlife Board for consideration and eventual approval. Before we do that, however, one thing that we like to do is do a public survey where we gauge public support for each regulation change that we're proposing. This year, we conducted a survey in three different parts. We set out three versions of the survey. Generally, these three versions were identical to each other with some exceptions I'll talk about in a minute here, but all three versions, first off, had the same questions about species, access, water body, and equipment preference of the angler. All three versions had the same questions pertaining to regulation changes that we're proposing in the southeastern region and the southern region. The reason that we put those two regions in every survey is each of those regions only requesting one regulation change. So as a result, only added a couple questions to the survey and didn't make the survey any longer by including those two regions into every version of the survey. Next, all three versions have the same multi-regional or statewide regulation questions. And then finally, all three versions have the same angler demographic questions. So what set the three versions of these surveys apart are the remaining three regions, the central region, the northeastern region, and the northern region. So we basically made a version of the survey that was specific to the central region and asked the regulations that were or questions on the regulations that are specific to the central region, one specific to the northeastern region, and one specific to the northern region. And the reason that we broke those three regions out is those three regions are asking or have a fair number of regulation changes that they're recommending. And if we package them all together in a single version of the survey, it was going to be a long survey. So we broke those out into three versions just to shorten the survey and make it easier for our anglers to complete. So we ended up sending the survey out to 8,481 randomly selected email addresses from our licensing database. If you total that across all three versions, it comes out to 25,443 randomly selected emails receiving the survey. We ended up receiving a response back from 16% of those who received the survey. This response rate is pretty typical of what we receive when we send the survey out. And then, as I mentioned, we did randomly select our email addresses, but we did stratify our email pool to help us receive responses in proportion to county population size and gender. And then what we did is we used the survey data to assess the support for each regulation change at 7 different levels. So the 7 levels are statewide support, support within the DWR region where the water body resides, support within the county where the water body resides. And then we looked at 4 additional factors. So species preference, water body preference, access preference, and equipment preference of the angler. And what we did for each regulation change that we're proposing is we looked at basically the anglers that would be most impacted by that regulation change. And we built a profile with species preference, water body preference, access preference, and equipment preference of those anglers that would be most impacted. And we looked for their support for each regulation change. So now I'm going to move on to the regulation changes the DWR is proposing for the upcoming 2023 fishing guidebook. And I'm going to start in the southeastern region. Here we have 1 regulation change that we're recommending. It's on Green River Golf Course Pond. Currently, that pond is listed as a community fishery here in the state, but we no longer stock it because there's poor survival of the fish that we stock into that pond. So what we did is we surveyed support for removing Green River Golf Course Pond from the list of community fisheries in the state. And that received support from 81 to 88% of the anglers that we surveyed. So throughout my presentation, I'm going to present the percent support from our survey as a range. What that range means is if you think back to the previous slide, when I talked about how we characterize support at 7 different levels, that range is the range of support across those 7 levels. So the group with the lowest support had 81% support for this regulation change. And the group with the highest level of support had 88% support. So based on that, what the DWR is going to recommend is that we remove the Green River Golf Course Pond from the list of community fisheries here in the state. And what that means, if we remove it from the list of community fisheries, is that the regulations on that pond will revert to statewide regulations. So now I'm going to move on to the southern region. We have 1 regulation change that we're proposing in the southern region, and that's at Navajo Lake. The current limit at Navajo Lake is 4 splake, brook trout, or tiger trout. That's a combined total across those 3 species, with the stipulation that only 1 of those 4 fish may exceed 22 inches. So what we did is we surveyed support for broadening the species list to include all trout species that are in the lake and Arctic grayling, which we went through a management planning process last fall and identified Arctic grayling as a species that we might add to Navajo Lake into the future. So this regulation change received support from 90 to 93% of those that we surveyed. As a result, the DWR is going to recommend that we apply a limit of 4 trout/grayling with the stipulation that only 1 of those 4 fish may exceed 22 inches at Navajo Lake. The reason that we're making this recommendation is the current regulation at Navajo Lake isn't truly inclusive of all the fish species that are at Navajo Lake. So what we'd like to do is recommend a regulation change that just reworks the regulation at Navajo change to really make it inclusive of all the trout species that are currently in the lake and what we're planning for the future with Arctic grayling to, again, simplify our regulations and make just easier for anglers to interpret the regulations at Navajo Lake. So now I'm going to move on to the Northeast region. We have several regulation changes we're going to propose in the Northeast region. The first one is a Big Sand Wash Reservoir, and this is a perch limit change. So the current limit for yellow perch at Big Sand Wash Reservoir is 50 fish. And what we did is we surveyed support for reducing that limit down to 10 yellow perch. That received support from 63 to 64% of the anglers that we surveyed in Duchesne County and within the Northeastern region. And it received between 73 and 79% support among the other groups that we identified. What the DWR is going to recommend is that we reduce the yellow perch limit at Big Sand Wash Reservoir down to 10 fish. The reason that we're making this recommendation is in recent years, we've seen the number of yellow perch within Big Sand Wash Reservoir decline. And what we're proposing is a limit change to reduce the harvest limit, to reduce the number of yellow perch that anglers are removing out of Big Sand Wash Reservoir for the intent of trying to build the yellow perch population in that reservoir and really just make it a higher quality, more consistent fishery for perch. Our next recommendation is also Big Sand Wash Reservoir, but this one is for walleye. So currently the statewide limit of 10 fish with the stipulation of only 1 of those fish may be over 24 inches applies at Big Sand Wash Reservoir for walleye. What we did is we surveyed support for changing that limit to 20 fish of any size. This recommendation received support from 49% of the anglers surveyed who identified themselves as walleye anglers. It received 56% support among anglers in Duchesne County and between 63 and 73% support among the other groups that we identified in our survey. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we apply a limit of 20 walleye of any size at Big Sand Wash Reservoir. There's really two reasons why we're making this recommendation. The first one is in recent years, we've seen walleye numbers at Big Sand Wash Reservoir really explode, and we're concerned about having a population collapse in the near future if we don't bring the numbers of walleye in that reservoir down. And we see that this regulation we're proposing is being a liberalized harvest limit that will help reduce the numbers of walleye at Big Sand Wash Reservoir to help prevent a population collapse from occurring. The second reason for this is yellow perch, as I talked about in the previous regulation, are an important prey source for walleye at Big Sand Wash Reservoir. And we feel that reducing the number of walleye within the reservoir is going to reduce the predation on the yellow perch and is going to help make it a more consistent yellow perch fishery at the reservoir. So what we feel like is in the end, this walleye recommendation that we're making is going to help us improve just the overall quality of the perch population and also the overall quality of the walleye fishery at Big Sand Wash Reservoir. Our next regulation recommendation is at Brown Duck Basin. Currently, Brown Duck Basin is closed to fishing from January 1st through 6 a.m. on the second Saturday of July. What we did is we surveyed support for removing that seasonal closure, and that received support from 83 to 87% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we remove the seasonal closure from Brown Duck Basin. And the reason we're making this recommendation is to provide additional angler opportunity and angler access by removing a seasonal closure. So we're essentially allowing anglers to fish year-round instead of half the year through this recommendation. Our next recommendation is on Jones Hole Creek. The current limit on Jones Hole Creek is two trout with the stipulation that only one of those two fish may be a brown trout over 15 inches. And there's an additional stipulation in Jones Hole Creek that only artificial flies and lures can be used. So what we did is we surveyed support for applying a limit of four trout any size at Jones Hole Creek, and this received support from 72 to 80% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we change the limit on Jones Hole Creek to four trout of any size at any species. The reason that we're making this recommendation is right now the densities of trout in Jones Hole Creek are fairly high, and this liberalized limit should help reduce the numbers of trout in the creek and promote better health of that overall fishery. As part of this recommendation, the DWR is recommending that the artificial fly and lure opportunity that's currently at Jones Hole Creek remains in place. Our next recommendation is at Pelican Lake, and this one's related to common carp. So anglers have the opportunity currently to release common carp at Pelican Lake if they catch them. We surveyed support for applying a catch and kill regulation for common carp at Pelican Lake, and that received support from 92 to 94% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we apply a regulation that does not allow the release of common carp and requires that all common carp that are caught are immediately killed. The reason that we're making this recommendation is we did a rote known treatment at Pelican Lake in 2018 specifically to remove common carp. We did this treatment because common carp numbers at Pelican Lake had reached levels where they were negatively impacting the fishery as a whole. We're seeing poor growth of bluegill and largemouth bass in particular because of the high numbers of common carp. What we've seen since 2018 is we've seen common carp begin to come back in the lake, and the DWR is trying to take a proactive, multifaceted approach to controlling carp numbers of the lake to prevent them from reaching the levels they were prior to the rote known treatment in 2018. So we've taken steps like we've introduced tiger muskie into the reservoir to serve as a predator on those common carp. And the division itself has mechanically removed common carp from the reservoir. And we see that this regulation recommendation is something else that we could take by allowing anglers to remove common carp and kill them by putting that as a requirement in place to help reduce common carp numbers and help, again, benefit the fishery. So in the end, we feel this regulation change should help improve the overall quality of fishing at Pelican Lake, particularly for our sport fish species like bluegill and largemouth bass. Our next regulation recommendation is another one at Pelican Lake, and this one's for bullhead. The current limit for bullhead at Pelican Lake is 24 fish, and what we did is we surveyed support for increasing that limit up to 50 fish. That received support from 86 to 87% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we increase the limit for bullhead at Pelican Lake to 50 fish. The reason that we're making this recommendation is currently there's a high number of bullhead in the lake, and what this does is it provides an additional harvest opportunity for anglers. Also, those bullhead can compete with other species, so this helps reduce the number of bullhead in the lake and should help improve the overall quality of the fishery at Pelican Lake. Our next recommendation is at Starvation Reservoir, and this is a panfish regulation change. So the current limit for bluegill, green sunfish, and black crappie and yellow perch at Starvation Reservoir is 20 fish, and that's a combined total across those species. What we did is we surveyed support for decreasing that limit down to 10 fish. This received support from 67% of anglers in Duchesne County and between 74 and 79% of the other anglers that we surveyed. So what we're going to formally recommend is that we reduce the panfish limit at Starvation Reservoir down to a combined total of 10 fish. There's two reasons that we're making this recommendation. The first reason is that fishing for these species, so bluegill, green sunfish, black crappie, and yellow perch, is very popular at Starvation Reservoir. And we've seen a decline in the number of these species in recent years. And we think that reducing the harvest limit is one step that we can take to help rebound the numbers of these species in Starvation Reservoir for the benefit of our anglers. The second reason for this regulation change is that Starvation Reservoir has one of the better walleye fisheries in the state, but we've seen a decline in walleye growth in recent years. The walleye in the reservoir feed primarily on these panfish species. So this regulation change also benefits the walleye by decreasing the harvest on their forage base and help building the numbers of these panfish species that are, again, their forage. So we think in the end, this regulation recommendation should help improve the overall quality and consistency of fishing for both panfish and walleye at Starvation Reservoir. Our next recommendation in the Northeast region is on the West Fork of the Duchesne River. So currently there are special regulations in place on the West Fork of the Duchesne that apply from the confluence of the North Fork upstream to the headwaters. What we did is we surveyed support for changing the stretch where these special regulations apply to above the confluence with Wolf Creek. This regulation recommendation received support from 70% of anglers that we surveyed in Duchesne County and between 79 and 84% support among the other groups that we surveyed. So what we're going to recommend is that we remove all special regulations from the stretch between North Fork and Wolf Creek. The reason we're making this recommendation is those regulations were in place to protect cutthroat trout in the stretch of river, but the reality is there aren't a lot of cutthroat trout in the stretch of river. So this regulation is unnecessarily restrictive, the current special regulation. So we think that removing this regulation and redefining where it applies only to stretches that have cutthroat trout, what it does is it increases angler opportunities by removing a seasonal closure and an artificial fly and lure restriction from a stretch of river that, again, lacks cutthroat trout. Our next regulation recommendation is on Wolf Creek itself. So currently the limit on the creek is 4 trout, with only 2 of those being cutthroat or trout with cutthroat markings. What we did is we surveyed support for a limit of 4 trout with no gear restrictions and no seasonal closure. This regulation received support from 77% of anglers on a statewide level and a little bit lower support, so 67 to 73% support among the other groups that we looked at. What the DWR is going to recommend is that we remove all special regulations from Wolf Creek. This increases angler opportunities by, again, removing a seasonal closure and an artificial fly and lure restriction from a stretch of river that lacks cutthroat trout. So the regulations are currently in place that protect cutthroat trout, but there's just not a lot of cutthroat trout in this river. It's primarily a brook trout, a brown trout fishery. So we feel that it'd be helpful for our anglers and beneficial for them to remove this restriction to provide additional angling opportunities. Okay, now I'm going to change gears. I'm going to talk about the regulations that we're proposing in the northern region. And the first one's at Tony Grove Lake. So the current limit at Tony Grove Lake is 4 trout. What we did is we surveyed support for increasing that limit up to 8 trout from August 15th to December 31st of each year. That received support from 92 to 94% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we apply a limit of 8 trout at Tony Grove Lake from August 15th to December 31st each year. The reason that we're making this recommendation is Tony Grove Lake is traditionally prone to winter kill. So what we like to do is provide anglers the opportunity to come in later in the year and harvest additional fish to help thin out numbers of fish, to help reduce the number that are lost in winter kill. And this also helps our anglers better utilize fish because we're providing anglers the opportunity to take fish home instead of having these fish naturally die during the winter months. So what this change does is it helps promote just additional angler harvest opportunities at Tony Grove Lake. Our next recommendation in the northern region is at State Line Reservoir, and this is a lake trout regulation change. So the current limit for lake trout is they're part of the 4 trout / kokanee salmon limit at the reservoir. We surveyed support for restricting lake trout harvest down to 1 fish with the release of all lake trout 22 inches or smaller. This recommendation received support from 83 to 87% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we continue the four trout slash coping salmon limit at state line reservoir, but add the stipulation that only one of those four fish may be a lake trout over 22 inches, and that all lake trout 22 inches or smaller must be immediately released. The reason that we're making this recommendation is actually related to the kokanee salmon population at state line reservoir, where there's a high number of kokanee salmon in that reservoir, and they're stunning because they're competing with one another. So we don't see good growth rates among those kokanee salmon. Lake trout are an important predator on kokanee salmon. So what this recommendation does is it helps bolster the lake trout population, so we could have more lake trout and larger lake trout. So those lake trout could feed more effectively on the kokanee salmon, thin the kokanee numbers, and hopefully lead to better kokanee growth. So this regulation really protects the predator population, so the lake trout in the reservoir, with the end goal of improving the quality of the kokanee salmon fishery within the reservoir. Our next recommendation is another one, state line reservoir, but this one applies to kokanee salmon. So currently kokanee are part of the four trout slash kokanee salmon limit at the reservoir. We surveyed support for adding a bonus limit of four additional kokanee salmon at that reservoir. This received support from 83 to 88% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we continue the four trout slash kokanee salmon limit at state line reservoir, but add a bonus limit of four kokanee salmon, meaning that anglers could take home up to eight fish at the reservoir, provided that at least four of those fish are kokanee salmon. Now, again, we're making this recommendation because we're trying to thin kokanee salmon numbers out at state line reservoir. So really the goal of this regulation is to help establish just a more consistent, higher quality fishery for kokanee salmon at the reservoir. Our next regulation recommendation is at Causey Reservoir. This is another lake trout regulation change. So currently lake trout are part of the four trout slash kokanee salmon limit at Causey Reservoir. We surveyed support for restricting lake trout harvest to one fish with the release of all lake trout 22 inches or smaller. This recommendation received support from 86 to 91% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the DWR is recommending is that we continue the four trout slash kokanee salmon limit at Causey Reservoir, but add the stipulation that only one of those four fish can be a lake trout over 22 inches, and that all lake trout 22 inches or smaller must be immediately released. Again, we're making this recommendation as it relates to kokanee salmon within the reservoir. There's a high number of kokanee salmon in Causey Reservoir. They're competing with one another, and we're seeing poor growth rates as a result. We started stocking lake trout in the Causey Reservoir about 4 years ago to try to establish a firmer predator population in that reservoir to help thin the kokanee salmon population out. So the goal of this regulation recommendation is to protect that predator, those lake trout that we stock in the Causey Reservoir, with the idea of building a more robust lake trout population so they can feed on the kokanee salmon, thin out their numbers, and have greater growth rates at the end of kokanee salmon within the reservoir. So this recommendation helps protect the predator population in the reservoir with the end goal of, once again, improving kokanee salmon size within Causey Reservoir. Our next recommendation is on the lower Bear River. So currently dead yellow perch cannot be used as bait on the lower Bear River. We surveyed support for allowing the use of dead yellow perch as bait. This received support from 87 to 96% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the division is going to recommend is that we allow dead yellow perch to be used as bait on the stretch of the lower Bear River between Cutler Dam and the Great Salt Lake. The reason that we're making this recommendation is statewide, we've allowed dead yellow perch to be used as bait in water bodies that already contain perch. In the case of the lower Bear River, the river itself has perch in it, but we don't have a regulation in place that allows dead yellow perch to be used as bait. So this opportunity basically makes things consistent across our waters in the state that have yellow perch by allowing them to be used, or allow dead yellow perch to use bait out of those waters. And what this does is it provides anglers, again, the opportunity to use a different bait in those waters. And in this case, it's dead yellow perch, and dead yellow perch already occur in the lower Bear River. Our next recommendation in the northern region is on Willard Creek Pond. Willard Creek Pond is not currently a community fishery. What we did is we surveyed support for making Willard Creek Pond into a community fishery. That received support from 94 to 97% of those that we surveyed. So what the DWR is going to recommend is that we add Willard Creek Pond to the list of community fishing ponds here in Utah. And if it's approved, we'll have a total of 59 community fishing ponds in Utah in 2023. And again, these are important opportunities because these community fishing ponds are located in the city itself, and they're primarily used by kids and families. And our last regulation recommendation for the northern region is on Lost Creek Reservoir. Foss Creek Reservoir is currently closed to fishing from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. daily. We surveyed support for removing that nighttime closure, and that received support from 92 to 94% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the division is going to recommend is that we remove this nighttime fishing closure at Lost Creek Reservoir. The reason that we have a nighttime fishing closure is Lost Creek Reservoir itself is an area that has poor cell phone coverage. And there's also, it's down a long road. It's difficult for emergency responders to go to the reservoir if an emergency happens. So the intent behind this nighttime closure was to prevent fishing access at night, just to promote safer conditions at the reservoir and prevent something from happening. Well, the reality is in the last couple of years, Lost Creek Reservoir has become a state park. And as part of that, there's better cell phone coverage up there and there's more emergency services up there. So we feel it's now safe for us to open that reservoir at night for fishing. So what this recommendation does is it really provides an additional fishing opportunity by allowing anglers to fish Lost Creek during the nighttime hours. Okay, so now I'm gonna move on to the central region, and our first water body we're making a recommendation for is Mona Reservoir within the central region. So currently statewide daily limits apply for all species at Mona Reservoir. And what we did is we surveyed support for doubling those limits. And this received support from 81 to 95% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what the division is gonna recommend is that we double the statewide limits for all species at Mona Reservoir. The reason that we're making this recommendation is traditionally Mona Reservoir has been prone to summerkill. It's traditionally a reservoir that has very low water levels. But the reality is every now and then there is a good water year where Mona Reservoir does fill up. And what happens is there's good inlet streams feeding into Mona Reservoir that have a good refuge population of sportfish in them. And when the reservoir is full, those fish quickly move out of those refuge streams, they reproduce, and we end up with a good population of fish in Mona Reservoir. The reality, however, the reservoir is drained so frequently that when we have good water years, there's a strong fish population, it's a short-lived opportunity because the reservoir is usually quickly drained and we lose that as a fishery. So we're making this recommendation so we can have a high harvest rate of fish at Mona Reservoir with the intent of providing anglers the opportunity to quickly harvest out a lot of fish during those good water years. So what this recommendation does is, again, provides an additional harvest opportunity in a reservoir that frequently has drought-related issues and low water levels. Our next recommendation is at Yuba Reservoir. So currently statewide harvest limits apply for all species at Yuba Reservoir. What we did is we surveyed support for doubling those limits for all species with the exception of tiger muskie. This received support from 75 to 96% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what we're gonna recommend is that we double the statewide limit for all species at Yuba Reservoir with the exception of tiger muskie. And our rationale for this is very similar to Mona Reservoir. So what I talked about in the last slide, Yuba Reservoir is another one that traditionally has very low summer water levels, and we're constantly concerned about summer kill happening at Yuba Reservoir. So what we're looking to do with this regulation recommendation is have a high harvest rate of fish at Yuba Reservoir, just to try to provide anglers the opportunity to take home a lot of fish when fishing conditions are good in that reservoir. So we can have anglers have a chance to take those fish home before a summer kill event happens. So again, this regulation recommendation provides additional harvest opportunity in a reservoir that frequently has drought-related issues in it. Our final recommendation for the central region is on a number of tributaries to Strawberry Reservoir. So there are several tributaries to Strawberry Reservoir that are currently closed to angling between September 1st and 6 a.m. on the second Saturday of October each year. So what we did is we surveyed support for removing that fall closure on all the tributaries of Strawberry Reservoir with the exception of Trout Creek. And I'll talk about why we're exempting Trout Creek here in a minute, but this recommendation received support from 74 to 91% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what we're gonna recommend is that we remove the current angling closure that lasts from September 1st through 6 a.m. on the second Saturday of October from the following tributaries of Strawberry Reservoir: Co-op Creek, Soldier Creek, Pole Canyon, Cow Hollow, Sage Creek, Chicken Creek, Little Co-op Creek, Clyde Creek, Mud Creek, Bryant's Fork, Forest Creek, Chipmunk Creek, Trail Hollow, Broad Hollow, Pine Hollow, Badger Hollow, and Road Hollow. As part of our recommendation, we're recommending that the springtime fishing closures that are currently apply on those creeks would still apply moving forward. We're also recommending that the catch and release regulation and the artificial fly and lure opportunities that apply on these creeks also applies under this new regulation. The reason we're making this recommendation is what this does is it increases fall fishing opportunities on the stream surrounding Strawberry Reservoir. These fall closures were initially put in place to protect spawning kokanee salmon, but the reality is these are all very small creeks, and they're so small they don't have spawning kokanee salmon in them. And so as a result, this closure unnecessarily restricted angling access. So we're trying to open up that access and create better fall fishing opportunities through this recommendation. Now, as I mentioned, we've exempted Trout Creek from this regulation change. The reason we've exempted Trout Creek is it's the biggest creek among those identified in the guidebook with this particular closure, and it has a spawning kokanee salmon population. So we like to continue to protect that spawning kokanee salmon population by continuing that fall closure on Trout Creek. Okay, so now I'm going to move to some regulation and recommendations that we have that actually apply to multiple regions. So the first one I'm going to talk about applies broadly to a handful of lakes within the Uinta Mountains. So if you look in the Uintas, currently there's a limit of 4 trout with a bonus limit of 4 additional brook trout, meaning that anglers have a chance to take home up to 8 fish in the Uintas, provided at least 4 of those fish are brook trout. What we did is we surveyed support for raising that limit to 8 trout, with continuing that bonus limit of 4 brook trout between August 15th and December 31st on 5 select lakes in the Uinta Mountains. I'll talk about those on the next slide. This recommendation received support from 90 to 94% of the anglers that we surveyed. So what we're going to recommend is that we apply a limit of 8 trout with a bonus limit of 4 brook trout between August 15th and December 31st on the following lakes: Marsh Lake, Beaver Lake, Quarter Corner Lake, Bridger Lake, and Teapot Lake. The reason that we're making this recommendation is these 5 waters are all traditionally been prone to winter kill. So what we'd like to do is provide anglers the opportunity to harvest additional fish later in the season before winter kill happens on these waters. So we want to provide anglers the opportunity to take these fish home. Now, one thing I want to point out is I included this as a regulation recommendation that influences multiple regions. But if you look at these 5 waters, they're all in the northern region. The reality is the lakes and streams in the Uinta Mountains cover 2 regions, so the northern region and the northeastern region. We view this regulation recommendation as actually being a pilot. So all these waters happen to be in the northern region, but there's a chance that if this regulation works out well, that in the future we may roll the same recommendation out to additional waters in the Uintas, including some in the northeastern region. And then our last regulation recommendation is actually a few recommendations that are all related to round-tailed chub in the state. So this kind of builds off of informational that we provided to the RACS and Wildlife Board last fall, where we introduced the idea of reclassifying round-tailed chub as a sport fish species here in Utah. Now, currently, round-tailed chub are considered a species of greatest conservation need, but their populations are actually strong enough here in the state that they can withstand some fishing pressure. And we see round-tailed chub as being a species that can provide a good fishing opportunity here in the state. This is a new species, a species that anglers haven't traditionally fished for because they have been a prohibited species here in the state. But the reality is, from talking to other states where they've done a similar reclassification, round-tailed chub are really an awesome species for anglers to catch. They take a wide range of flies and lures. They even take some baits. They live in a large river setting as well, which is a very different environment. We don't have a lot of large rivers here in the state where anglers can fish. So this is truly a unique opportunity. So what we've done in the past year is we've done a more thorough evaluation of the potential of round-tailed chub as a sport fish species here in the state. And we feel that there's 3 regulations that we would like to propose that could be applied to Utah's round-tailed chub populations. So the first regulation recommendation that the DOWR would like to propose is an artificial fly and lure regulation with a catch and release restriction. And that applies, if you look at the map on the right hand of the slide, to the waters that are identified in black. So those are kind of the bottom right corner of the map. So the 2 waters that are affected here are the Escalante River from the Pine Creek confluence down to Lake Powell, and McElmo Creek from the Colorado state line to the San Juan River. The second regulation that we would like to propose is that any gear with a 2 fish limit, and that would apply to all the waters that are identified in blue on the map. So those include the main stem of the Colorado River from the Dirty Devil River confluence to the Colorado state line, the Dolores River from the Colorado state line to the Colorado River confluence, the Green River from the San Juan boat launch down to the Colorado River confluence, the entire length of the San Rafael River, and the White River from the Colorado state line to the tribal land boundary. And the final regulation that we would like to recommend is that any gear catch and release restriction for round-tailed chub on the Green River from the Colorado state line down to the Sandwash Boat Launch. So that's identified in red on the map over here. We did survey anglers about these three different regulations, and they showed in our survey that anglers supported it at a level of 78 to 96%. So what the DWR is going to formally propose is that we remove round-tailed chub from the list of prohibited fish here in Utah. That's going to have some effect in rules R657-13-13 and R657-14-8. Both these rules present lists of prohibited fish. We're proposing that we remove round-tailed chub from those lists. Our second recommendation is that we apply the three regulation types that I talked about on the last slide to our round-tailed chub fisheries here in the state. Again, we're making this recommendation because round-tailed chub would be a new sport fish species in the state, so it'd be a new fishing opportunity. On top of that, the round-tailed chub lives in some large rivers in the Green River and Colorado River systems here in the state that are traditionally underutilized by our anglers. So we're providing anglers a new opportunity in some rivers that just aren't heavily fished. In fact, if this recommendation is approved, it would open up 839 additional miles of fishing opportunity here in Utah. So one thing I want to point out with this regulation recommendation is this is a new opportunity here in the state. So anglers have not traditionally had the opportunity to fish for round-tailed chub. So if we allow access for round-tailed chub and this recommendation is approved, the DWR is going to closely monitor our round-tailed populations in the state and make any adjustments to these regulations that are necessary as we see what impact these regulations have on our round-tailed chub populations. So that formally concludes the division's fishing regulation recommendations that we would like to make for the upcoming 2023 fishing guidebook. I'd like to close my presentation by providing just a brief informational on two topics. The first is an update on an angler opportunity assessment that we've been working on for the last several years. And I also want to provide the RACs and the Wildlife Board just an update on some upcoming regulation changes that we'll be proposing that relate to Flaming Gorge Reservoir. So I want to start off by talking about our angler opportunity assessment. This is something that we've provided updates to in front of the RACs and Wildlife Board for the last 4 or 5 years. But just as a reminder, our goal is to provide fishing opportunities in Utah relative to the demand among our anglers and also ensure that those opportunities are within a distance that our anglers are willing to travel. Well, in order to achieve this goal, we need a lot of data, and that data comes from something we call the Utah Statewide Survey. This statewide survey is something we perform every 5 years in collaboration with Utah State University. Unfortunately, the last survey was completed in 2016, and that 2016 data and any previous surveys that we completed didn't provide the data really required to perform this assessment. So the most recent iteration of the survey was performed in 2021. And when we designed the 2021 survey, we specifically designed it to address the data gaps so we could achieve this goal that I talked about. We were hoping that we would receive the results from the survey from Utah State University in time to do a more in-depth informational for the RACs and Wildlife Board this fall. But unfortunately, there's been some delays in processing the data, and we haven't been handed the results yet. So we aren't able to provide that more in-depth update, but we anticipate receiving the results from Utah State at any time. Once we receive the results, we're going to review them. And then with the next regulation cycle, we're going to focus on a few things. So first, doing an inventory and assessing the capacity of our existing fisheries to meet the needs of our angler preference groups across the state. We'll look at modifying our management to meet the needs and desires of our anglers. And then we'll also look at addressing any gaps with the creation of new angling opportunities here in the state. And the final update that I want to provide is again related to Flaming Gorge Reservoir. So currently there are a lot of differences in fishing regulations that occur between the Utah and Wyoming sides of Flaming Gorge, and this lack of consistency creates some confusion among our anglers. Both Utah and Wyoming are aware of this confusion that's created. Both agencies are working collaboratively towards establishing a common set of regulations that would apply across the entire length of the reservoir. So our intent here is over the next year or 2 years, we're going to work with Wyoming, and both agencies are going to come up with sets of regulations that we're going to take through our respective processes. And once both Wyoming has made some regulation changes and Utah's made some regulation changes, really the end goal is to again create one set of consistent regulations across all of Flaming Gorge. So the reason I'm providing this update is I just want to let the RACs and Wildlife Board know that you should expect to see a suite of regulation changes be proposed in the next year or 2 years. They're all going to be related to Flaming Gorge, again, with this end goal of trying to create consistent regulations across the entire reservoir. So I'd like to thank you for your time today. Also, I just want to point out that either myself or Craig Walker, the warm water sportfish coordinator, will be at the RAC and Wildlife Board meetings, and we'd be happy to take any questions that you have as they relate to either the informational items that I provided or the fishing regulation changes we're proposing. Again, thank you.